brother, this guy stinks!
Always going to be the conversation of, should T'Challa ever be recast? It is Chadwick Boseman, the only person who can play Black Panther. I have my own opinions on it, but I'm writing in a column. But I'm interested in what y'all think about whether this character can ever be anyone but Chadwick Boseman.
I think everyone has their right to how they think it should unfold. You know, I will say, as a fan of the books, the Black Panther to me is a mantle, right? And was a mantle in the first movie because his dad was the Panther. It's clearly something that's been handed down. I think that the story we want to tell is a specific story. It's not going to be the story everybody wants us to tell. And that's okay. You know what I mean? I think we only know how to tell the story that we know how to tell. And I hope when the movie comes out, people respond to it and take it for what it is. I think some people are going to come out of the movie going, no, we still believe what we think. And that's okay. We had to make the movie that we understood how to make. And Ryan had to write the movie that he understood how to write. The rest is up to you guys.
Now you see something? You know you don't fucked up, right?
No! I said no! I said I pulled into the garage
You know you don't fucked up, right?
No!
At the National Association of Black Journalists event that they did in Las Vegas, you said it was a couple weeks ago?
Mm-hmm.
Somebody finally did the task of actually asking someone from Marvel, in this case specifically Nate Moore, his thoughts on the whole recast T'Challa situation, which now we have video proof that they know. Mm-hmm. They know this is a thing.
Sure.
Which E-Man has told us before that they know, but mm-hmm. we have actual tangible proof that they are aware that this is a thing. And Nate Moore goes to answer the question about it, and this is where I let Marcus take the reins on this one.
The first point I want to get to is that I don't think this is anywhere close to the first time that he's been asked about this. I think it's the first time we were able to witness it on film and see what his responses have been.
Mm-hmm.
But I don't think this was the first time, even in that convention, that he was asked about this. Because if you listen closely in the video, right before he begins to, you know, hopscotch through his answer, the host of the Q&A kind of says, "Again?" As if that's been a constant question there in the conference during the session.
Did not catch that.
So I don't think this is the first time. I think this is the first time we've been fortunate enough to see somebody, right? Because it obviously hasn't been. I don't think, unless they, you know, have quashed the interview or quashed the question. But I don't think it's been from a major outlet as of yet. But this was a conference of journalists,
mm-hmm.
right? This was a conference of journalists ranging from you know, corporate journalism, CNN, NBC, ABC, all of that kind of stuff, down to regular, you know, run-of-the-mill, your local newspaper, internet blogs, what have you. There was writers, right? And in a room full of objectified question answers, or objective question answerers, askers. I don't know why that came out so jumbled. Effective, objective question askers.
Perfect.
Is essentially what they were where he was in. It was not a question that could be avoided. Shout out to the columnist, to the writer who asked the question.
Do we know where he's from?
I don't.
Because
I have not been able to. Well, actually, hold on.
The reason why I ask is because if this is at least the second question that was asked about recast T'Challa, and this was the first one filmed, I would probably believe that he was with the person that filmed it.
Okay, so let's try to find dude, because I do remember him saying that he was waiting to post it, the person who posted the video. So let's see, maybe if that's... Well, that's just the person who was there, though. We'll have to do some more.
Yeah, I would have to believe that if it was asked twice, at least twice,
mm-hmm.
that there was a reason why this one was filmed. And I don't think Marvel or whoever from the NABJ is filming it. I would think
he Yeah, no, it's just it. Somebody in the audience, for sure, for sure. But I don't know if that necessarily means... Catch. Well, maybe he didn't record the first couple of times that they asked him, and it was like, all right, well, I ain't gonna miss this shit again. And then he was it's ready
possible.
For the last
Definitely
one,
possible.
You know?
Or maybe that person came with an agenda to ask about recast T'Challa and get it on tape.
Hey, listen, I'm good with either explanation.
Sure.
Because I got the question asked.
Just wondering.
You know, on camera.
I would like to big up, bro, if that was the
yeah,
case.
Yeah, for sure, for sure. I appreciate it either way. If you were just an innocent bystander or a sleeper cell agent, thank you. But yeah, that's the first part of it. I don't think this is the first time that they've actually had to answer this question literally. But I think, man, I sound like him, don't I? But I think I do think that how he responded is kind of a microcosm to how all of this has been handled.
Yes.
Right? So he begins by saying that we all have an opinion on how we think the story should go. Not the question that was asked. True enough, I guess, you know, there are opinions that are based on, you know, a reading history, based on canon from the character, based on, you know, long-term fandom that predated the movie in 2018. But an opinion is an opinion. Everybody's got one. So true enough, but that's not what was asked. That's not what was asked of you. You were asked, do you believe no one could ever play T'Challa? Now, we got a little bit of pushback. I did. When I talked about this on Twitter, well, he can't confirm or deny what's going to happen in Black Panther 3 or any other Black Panther projects going forward. Again, that wasn't the ask.
Yeah.
The ask was not about any future casting decisions. The ask didn't even allude to anything beyond Black Panther 2. I don't even think that the question was overtly about Black Panther 2. It was stated in a very general sense. And again, we're talking about a room full of literary people who say what they mean, for the most part, mean what they say by way of their occupation.
Masters of rhetoric.
So I think he said exactly what he wanted to say as to give Nate Moore an opportunity to speak on this without having to address the movie. He didn't say, do you see yourself recasting T'Challa down the line? Do you believe T'Challa could come back into the universe? Is Wakanda Forever going to be setting up an eventual turn for Wakanda? Nothing like that. Do you, Nate Moore, believe that someone else, another black actor, can play T'Challa? Is that your belief? That's a benign enough question that you can give a better answer than, well, firstly, everyone has their opinion on how this should go. And then it gets worse from there. I believe that as a comic reader, that Black Panther is a mantle, right? Nate, I'm going to try to give this to y'all. I'm actually going to try to stop yelling so much. I'm going to try and do this without screaming, right? Because I realize that me saying at the top of my lungs, screaming that, hear what I say, I know I'm right, and I'm just screaming it. It's not gonna ever be a thing that people are gonna be able to wade through. I can't expect people to see through passion or excitement or loudness to see logic, because people don't see logic when you speak it to them calmly either. So I guess the better road is the one less treacherous and less stressful for me.
But it's
if that's
going to
be the reverse,
it's the people going.
Sure, and it'll come up every now and again. But I've had a couple of days to reflect on all of this.
Fair enough.
So Nate Moore saying that Black Panther is a mantle, and that's representative of that of the character and the story that's being told through Wakanda, is as close a thing to a flat out lie. And I don't say that, I don't say it lightly, and I'm not using hyperbole. I mean, it is a literal lie. The fact that the Black Panther story, the title, the IP itself, is built around the mantle of Black Panther is a lie. And I say that because there is empirical evidence. I mean, a literal database that will tell you out of 600, 500 or so issues, however many there are of Black Panther, that T'Challa has been present in about 90% of those stories, that there is only a handful of people that have ever worn the mantle other than T'Challa in the comic books. I'm not talking canonically here. I'm talking about have actually had stories written about them. Please don't flood the comments with the, oh, it's been passed down from line to line to line to line. There's been so many Black Panthers. You don't know any of them. You don't know any of them. Who wrote the Bashanga solo series? Who wrote the T'Chaka solo series? Trick question. Do those solo series even exist? Shuri, M'Baku, Killmonger, T'Challa present through all of those storylines. He's there. He is the protagonist. And it's just, it's silly to me to suggest otherwise. Nate, you are a high-ranking Marvel employee, and your name and your word carries weight in certain circles. But the arrogance, right, in having a Marvel Unlimited platform where all of this information is easily accessible, not to mention the decades of comic book reading that have been done before you were even born, to try and revise the history of Black Panther and T'Challa to fit your marketing. That's insulting. That is insulting. That would be like telling the Thor fandom that they should love Thor Love and Thunder because Thor's always been an oaf. He's always been a dim-witted, can't-do-right, gullible, likable character. That's who he's always been, right? No, that's just not true. Yeah, everyone can have an opinion, but where empirical evidence can be introduced and disprove that, then it becomes a lie. The only way it's not a lie is if he just doesn't know, truly does not know, has not done the research, has not done the work, which in itself is a lie because you started off with this saying that you were a comic fan. You would be hard pressed to show me a quote unquote mantle that is not held up even to the point of being able to loan it out to other peripheral characters, therefore driving the brand forward for that main protagonist. But you'd be hard pressed to show me a mantle for a superhero character that is more important than the actual protagonist. That just doesn't exist. It's never been done that way. It's never been propagated that way. And it's never been successful that way. It's not that way for James Bond. It's not that way for Bruce Wayne. You know that the list goes on and on and on. Clark Kent, Peter Parker, so on and so on. It doesn't work like that. That's not how it goes. And people think that because they heard in the first 5 minutes of Black Panther that the title's been passed down from generation to generation, that they understand what it is they're talking about. And Nate Moore is parroting those people. So he is either lying through his teeth or he is one of those fans that doesn't know. It can't be anything else. Literally, it can't be. We know what is true. What is provable? What can you pull out to support your perspective? Nate Moore has a fallacy to support his. There's nothing empirical about what that man said. Black Panther, the IP, the title, has never been about the mantle. Ever. And anyone who reads Black Panther comics knows that. Now, on to some of the more irritating parts of his answer. So after the mantle talk, we started getting into a level of communication that I haven't really seen out of Marvel in terms of speaking to fans. And again, the context of this Q&A is not that of D23 or Comic-Con or something like that. You know, it's not a fan-driven event.
Yeah.
So a little bit of grace can be given in that regard because he's not serving the same crowd. However, when addressing this question, I think everyone on all sides, pro-recast, anti-recast, somewhere in between, I think we can all say that this question is a question that's posed from and responded to the Black community. You're talking to us. You're not talking to general MCU fandom. When it comes to Black Panther and what ends up happening to the one of the oldest Black superheroes there is, you're talking to us. And so in that respect, to hear hey, it might not be what you want, but it's what you're going to get. Let me quote him literally. It may not be what you want, but it was the movie that we were able to provide you. Now, riddle me this. Is Disney not the studio, excuse me, Marvel? Is Marvel not the studio that bends over backwards to serve the fans? Is that not something that they brand themselves after?
Yes.
That they continuously pat themselves off the pat themselves on the back in a very public manner for doing. Mm-hmm. In interviews and in their own press promotion, they go out of their way to show you that they are serving various communities, various identities, and doing so gleefully and proudly. Right? That's the Marvel brand? Or have I been watching another company for these last 20 years or so? So for the studio that wants to bend over backwards to please all of its fans, a few examples from at least this year, the bolstering of Mark Spector's religious identity, I guess, wasn't necessarily a thing that was a huge focus initially in the testing screenings. And obviously that upset some people within the Jewish community. And they went back and they did reshoots and they gave him a yarmulke, make sure he was wearing the Star of David, made sure that they served that community in a way that made them feel represented, not just represented in general, but adequately. And they gleefully flaunted that they were willing to do that, and they made sure everyone knew about it. Explain to me what the difference is. And don't say that this is a controversial issue so they can't choose a side, because every Jewish person in America didn't rant and rave about Mark Spector not wearing a yarmulke. Not every Jewish person even agreed with the sentiment. And yet, there was a group of that community that was vocal enough to see the change through. Why don't we deserve that? Why don't we get that? It doesn't have to be a majority. It doesn't have to be all. It don't have to be 51%. There are enough Marvel viewers that have questions around your handling of this character to cause for pause. Let's reevaluate. Let's at least address the concerns coming from that community. And that's why I said this was so unique, because this is the first time we've heard him outside of the Ringerverse podcast addressed this part of the fandom. And when he finally does, he tells us that we ain't got McDonald's money. Y'all can have burgers at home. Y'all got McDonald's money? Y'all about to have McDaddy's at the crib.
Whack Arnold's.
I'm sorry. Did you fall and bump your head and forget that you are the Please Me studio? That you are the representation studio? What happened? Oh, you over there, take what we give you. And that was the tone in which it was given. It was very matter of fact. It was very, hey, look, I know that you guys don't want this. And I know that it's not ideal, but you're getting it anyways. And then the final nail in the coffin for me was, the only thing that we can do is make the movie that we know how to make. That's the only thing that Ryan could do, was write the movie that he knew how to write. And the rest is up to you. How can that be seen as anything less as an ultimatum? Or at very least, a juxtaposition that puts you as a fan and a critic of what's going on with the character in the precarious position of having to choose between supporting the black movie and getting what you would want out of representation through this character. For somebody who's had to have gone through media training at great depth, right, holding the position that he holds, was there any way possible for him to be more dismissive to the people who wanted an answer around T'Challa's longevity in the future of the MCU than, hey, come see it if you want. If you don't agree, that's on you. We did what we wanted to do. Because that is a successful formula for a billion-dollar superhero film franchise. Write the story that you want to do regardless of what the fans are calling for. That's the Marvel formula? Is that what any other community that you can point to has gotten? Have they ever gotten a response like that? I've done a lot of pondering on why it is that he even felt comfortable to speak so matter-of-factly. Like, it felt like a scolding to a certain degree. It was like, hey, look, man, I get it. Recast T'Challa and whatnot, but this is what we're doing. So let's just try to move forward. It felt like Jay-Z telling us to move forward from fucking kneeling. That's what it felt like. It felt like a condescension. it felt like it almost felt like he was unprepared to answer the question, so he dismissed it, and he kind of hopped around answering the question itself. And so I kind of think about the reasons why.
Mm-hmm.
Number one, there is statistical evidence that suggests that the way that we spend our money is a little less, we meaning the community,
mm-hmm.
right, is a little less nuanced, at least as of late, in terms of how they sell the product to us. And it all kind of boils down to whether or not it's wearing a black face. You know, it's tied to how we consume, because we will support corporations ran by white billionaires all day as long as they have a black face on it somewhere, but struggle to support budding black businesses that don't have the same cachet.
Or vote for white presidents who have a black checkered vice history, president, yeah. even though he says you ain't black if you don't vote for him and dumb shit like that.
You know what I mean? The way that we associate our allegiances, certainly as a voting bloc, but I think as a community, there's some connection there. So that's one thing. I don't think that they, at least up until most recently, where they can't seem to put any Black Panther news out without recast T'Challa being at the forefront of the discussion. But at least going into this, while they were creating the film, while they were shooting, I don't think that they expected to meet opposition to what they were doing. It doesn't mm-hmm. seem like it, at least not to me. And it's still pretty early. We just got the first trailer last month. We still got a couple more trailers to go. And then obviously they'll be trying to push very hard on the holiday season to get people to come out and see it. So,
and truthfully, they probably weren't seeing this much backlash when they first announced it.
No, they weren't, because it was only a very niche amount of the community that follows this news and knew about it.
Yeah.
Preemptively. We knew exactly that we would be right here 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm.
We knew that without a shadow of doubt. Takes a while for everybody else to catch up because they're not following the news like we are.
Mm-hmm.
So that's number one. Number two, indulge me for a second. If you went into this thinking that you were going to be able to elevate Shuri, you know, put the black girl magic meter up to 1,000 and not have T'Challa, and the movie would be successful, right? Then you find, in the midst of shooting the movie being delayed, now you have a petition, you have hashtags, you've got, you know, the various celebrities that have come along and asked questions about what we're doing here and come out and support. You know, I think it was a lot more than they accounted for. So if that's your thought process and you see the popularity around the character T'Challa, that they're not so set into doing what they want to do thematically that they don't see money. That is not happening, because they are still selling Chadwick Boseman Funko Pops. They are still selling Chadwick Boseman Marvel Legend action figures. They put his face in the trailer. So they do see the value in the character and how he can continue to make profit. So knowing that, and knowing that we're not going to get him in the second movie, what are the possibilities? Now, at this point, this is all speculation. This is my brain. I'm just giving you a peek into what's going on up here. You're not going to lose money perpetually every time you put out a Black Panther product. You're just not going to do that. As much as they virtue signaled that this thing is about a mantle, I believe the first week, the second week, the third week numbers will show you that a superhero franchise without its protagonist is dead in the water. But that's my opinion, right? But they are not going to continue to see the interest for T'Challa and just let those dollars go by the wayside. So what if the only thing sadder than the loss of a king, death of a king, tragic loss of a brother, of it, maybe even father by the end of this movie, than the triumphant return of the lost father and king, intentionally infusing the tragedy around Chadwick Boseman's death to capitalize on this movie, only to capitalize on it again when you return the character from the dead? The only thing more popular, or the only thing more powerful than seeing the king die is the triumphant return. What if at some point they realized that the anticipation for this character is served better edged? What if they are using our emotions around everything that's going on with this movie to double dip into the Chadwick Boseman bucket? Just a theory. Just a theory. And I don't think that has any implications on recast T'Challa or, you know, anybody looking to boycott the film. Because if that's the case, that's manipulation.
Mm-hmm.
Beyond even what we've kind of parsed through in the steps that they've already taken. Like, that's dastardly. But then again, I don't know why people forget about some of the heinous things that have come out of the House of Mouse. So it's not all the way out of the question either.
Yeah.
I don't know, man. I just felt like his response was very dismissive. It felt like he was talking to a specific crowd, because he was talking to a specific crowd. There's no way, if you were telling me something about Shang-Chi's future in the MCU, right, and how that character was going to be represented and put forth in his film franchise, I would not expect that response to be catered to my demographic.
Yeah.
So of course he's talking to Black Panther fans. Of course he's talking to Black MCU fans. And his response was to you, hey, I'm not answering that T'Challa question, but if you feel like he should be in there, that's okay. He's not going to be. You can either buy it or not.
Crazy that we got here from the person who fought so hard to get Black Panther on film.
You want to know why I know that there's a little bit of grift involved in this? There, like, Nate Moore, you're on tape talking about how people need to love T'Challa for this franchise to be successful.
And we knew that for people to love the Black Panther franchise, they needed to love T'Challa.
Done.
They need to love who?
In order for people to love the Black Panther, they had to first love T'Challa.
For people to love the Black Panther franchise, they needed to love T'Challa.
So it's just so interesting that $1.3 billion in, right? Sequel movie, and all of a sudden, it's about the mantle. Now, was it about the mantle before you said that everybody needs to be T'Challa? Before Ryan Coogler tried to create the Black James Bond? Before it made $1.3 billion? And then somewhere along the way, in between there and contract negotiations to get Chadwick Boseman on for Black Panther 3 and Chadwick Boseman's untimely passing, it all reverted back to the mantle? Listen, if you truly are doing this because you feel like it is the best thing to honor Chadwick Boseman, it is not necessary for you to try to hijack or assimilate the history of Black Panther to do that. Even if you were going to write him in a funeral scene, even if you were going to kill him off, even if you weren't going to have T'Challa in the MCU again, you do not have to lie and say now that the franchise is built on whoever wears the suit. It is not incumbent on you to erase the protagonist to uplift the mantle. And I know you know that, because in any other case where that happens, the main protagonist is still there in their story. Hawkeye, Thor, Hulk. Everybody gets to elevate along with their protege, their apprentice, their replacement, what have you, except for Black Panther. Everything else is about the protagonist in the story except for the Black Panther mantle. There have been more solo runs to non-Thor Thors than there have been for Black Panther. Same thing for Spider-Man. There have been more non-Peter Parker solo runs for Spider-Man than there ever were for Black Panther. But yet, Black Panther is the one where anybody can put on the suit, and Peter Parker is the one who will show up in any film adaptation Spider-Man related ever. They even shoehorned him into Venom 2, which, what the hell did that have to do with anything? So yeah, he's off on a few of these points empirically, not just by way of opinion or lack of knowledge, definitively wrong. Not to mention you had a completely different stance on this prior to the first movie coming out. What changed? It didn't surprise me all that much, but it did surprise me that he wasn't prepared for the question.
Right.
That he stumbled through it so much to the point where he completely avoided saying anything about the man's actual question.
Especially since he got it multiple times.
Yeah. So give us your thoughts. What did you think about Nate Moore's response to a recast T'Challa question? Make sure you like, share, and subscribe, and give us your thoughts in the comments below.
Absolutely, and make sure you check out our recast T'Challa playlist just to kind of catch up on all the news surrounding Black Panther 2 and the recast T'Challa movement. And make sure you subscribe. Like he said, we like to talk about as much Black Panther 2 news as we can provide for you.